All right, Introduction to Ethics, Lecture 1. I want to start by talking about the subject of ethics in a general way and talking about a big philosophical topic, the question of knowledge. Philosophy focuses to a great extent on the subject of knowledge. And I want to start in by thinking about the connection between morality or ethics. For our purposes of the moment anyway, I'm going to use those terms interchangeably. Ethics, morality. What do we mean by ethics or morality? Well, questions to do with right or wrong, questions to do with good and bad, questions to do with value, questions to do with what is morally permissible or right or morally obligatory, questions to do with moral duties, moral obligations. And in these areas, it's a widely held view that there are no objective truths. That is to say, this is not really an area where knowledge is possible. This is not really an area where we have knowledge. I don't say that that's a universally accepted view, but you certainly encounter it a lot. It's certainly a widely held view. And I think it would be useful to start off the course by talking about the status of moral knowledge and what we should think about the possibility of moral knowledge. What is the connection between morality and knowledge? Again, I'll just start in a general way by observing that it is a commonly held view. You do encounter this a lot, that there aren't any objective truths when it comes to right and wrong, when it comes to good and bad. One sometimes hears reasons offered in support of this view, a view we might term non-objectivism. So let's start by asking whether the reasons that people have for holding that view are good reasons. That is to say, are they reasons that really do establish the thesis, that is to say, the non-objectivist thesis? So here again, by non-objectivism, I would mean the view according to which there are no objective truths when it comes to these kinds of questions. What is right? What is wrong? What is good? What is bad? What should we think about the status of knowledge in these areas? And what are the reasons that people have for being skeptical that knowledge is not a possibility in these areas? So that would be, again, the non-objectivist view, or what I've called a skeptical view here of the possibility of moral knowledge. Let's just think about some of the reasons that you commonly encounter, reasons that people commonly cite, reasons that people commonly give for thinking that there isn't any knowledge in this domain of human thought, this domain of human activity, issues to do with right and wrong, issues to do with value, good and bad. Is that true? Why do people hold that view? Well, let's just think about some of the common reasons that one does oftentimes hear. Sometimes the way that this point is made is by pointing to a distinction between matters of opinion and matters of fact. So here again, this point, this thesis that there is no knowledge in the area of right and wrong. Again, I'm calling that the non-objectivist thesis. Again, by way of contrast, objectivism would be the view that knowledge, here again, this is one way to think about it, this is one way that I would explain it. The objectivist thesis would be the view that knowledge is possible when it comes to questions of right and wrong. Here again, let's start off on the other side of the coin, thinking about the non-objectivist view, which you also encounter a lot, and think about some of the reasons that people have for holding that view, and think about this critical question, are they good reasons? So with respect to the non-objectivist position, that there is no knowledge, there is no objective truth, you might say, when it comes to right and wrong. One way that people will defend that position would be to point to a distinction between what they would call matters of opinion on the one side and matters of fact on the other side. And the claim would be that when it comes to what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is bad, these are only matters of opinion. And so, as if drawing that distinction somehow removes the possibility of acquiring knowledge, of establishing knowledge about such questions. That doesn't follow. And there are lots of reasons why that doesn't follow, but I'll just make one point about that right now. One point that I would make is that there are matters of opinion in science and math as well. But I take it no one is going to argue that there is no knowledge in science or math. Okay? But if there are matters of opinion in science of math, and pretty much everyone agrees that there is knowledge, and knowledge is attained, knowledge is achieved in the physical sciences and in mathematics, then that can't be a reason for thinking that there's no possibility of moral knowledge. There's no possibility of knowledge about values, about good and bad, about moral knowledge, about right and wrong. Because matters of opinion exist in every domain of human investigation. Every branch of human inquiry, there are matters of opinion. So lack of knowledge in any, you know, in any area, it doesn't mean that there's no point to trying to get closer to the truth, you might say, trying to establish knowledge, even if in some areas that's more difficult than others. And perhaps in morality, it is more difficult to establish knowledge claims than it is in, say, the physical sciences or the formal sciences like math and logic for many reasons that we'll get into going forward. But suffice it to say for the moment that there are matters of opinion in every area of inquiry. And we don't therefore conclude that no knowledge is possible. Or at least virtually no one concludes that there's no knowledge, there's no possibility of knowledge in math and science. Well, there are matters of opinion in math and science. So that can't be a good reason for holding the non-objectivist view. It's not a reason that establishes the non-objectivist thesis, the thesis that there is no moral knowledge. Even about matters of opinion, of course, there may be a right and wrong opinion. There may be right and wrong answers, we just don't know what they are. So even if something is regarded as a matter of opinion in the sense that claims in that area have not been established as true, again, it wouldn't follow that there is no true opinion or there is no true claim. It may just be that inquiry into the matter, investigation of the matter, has not advanced to the point where we would say that the claim rises to the status of knowledge. From the fact that an opinion is merely an opinion, of course, it doesn't follow that it can't at some point become knowledge. So from the fact that no opinion is known to be right, it doesn't follow that there is no right opinion. This is an important distinction to bear in mind, I think, when it comes to morality. You know, oftentimes the subject of morality, philosophical discussion of it, ordinary discussion of it, oftentimes focuses on moral controversies, areas where people are pretty much divided, society is pretty much divided, and there are very strong feelings on one side of the issue and on the other. And, of course, in that situation, oftentimes we speak of the different opinions with respect to the issue, but of course from the fact that no opinion again is known to be the right opinion, it wouldn't follow that there is no right opinion. All that follows from that is that we just don't know which opinion is the true opinion, which opinion is the right opinion. And it is arguably the case that the only way that we're going to come to know is to continue to investigate the matter, to continue to examine the matter in a rational way. So consider some of these statements. Here are some examples from the history of math and science. consider the statement that the Earth orbits the Sun. Okay, well, there was a time when that was a matter of opinion. It is now regarded, of course, as a well-established fact. But in the 16th century, when Copernicus proposed the heliocentric model of our planetary system and said that the Sun is at the center and the Earth orbits the Sun, his opinion was a minority opinion. Most people, even most astronomers at that time, thought that the geocentric model, the model of our planetary system according to which the Earth is at the center, was true. So that was a matter, not only was it a matter of opinion, not only did Copernicus have an opinion that could not be established in his time as a fact, of course it did eventually become established as a fact. It took a lot more astronomical observation, it took a lot more work in physics before the Copernican hypothesis was confirmed. So at the time Copernicus proposed it, he was pretty much the only person who held that opinion. So we're talking about a very unpopular opinion, even one that very few people in this example held at a given time. But that opinion turned out to be the true opinion. It took time to establish that it took a long time, as a matter of fact, to establish that it was the true opinion. But my point here is that from the fact that it was a matter of opinion, it didn't follow, of course, at that time, as well as now, of course, it didn't follow that there's no fact of the matter. Just because no opinion has been established to be the fact of the matter, it doesn't follow that there is no fact of the matter. So that would be an example of an opinion that became a fact. Consider the statement Sirius is 200 million years old. That's the closest star to us after our sun. That would be an example of a statement in science that is still a matter of opinion. Astronomers who study this question disagree. There are a range of views on that question. One end of the spectrum would be 200 million years old. Probably the other end of the spectrum would be Sirius is 300 million years old. So there are differences of opinion among astronomers as to the age of the star Sirius. But, of course, from the fact that there are different opinions, it doesn't follow that none of those opinions is the true opinion. One of the, perhaps, as astronomical observation advances, as it becomes more precise, one of those opinions will be established as a fact, and then it will have gone from a matter of opinion to a matter of fact. So just calling something a matter of opinion does not have the consequence that there is no fact of the matter. It may just be that at this time we don't know what the true opinion is. The only way that we're going to find out is by more investigation, and that goes for morality and ethics just as much as it would go for any other branch of knowledge, any other branch of inquiry. Take the statement, water is composed of two parts hydrogen and one part oxygen. That is a matter of fact that is well established now, but here again, there was a time, in the case of this example, you don't even have to go back that far as compared to the Copernicus example, excuse me, as compared to the first example. In this case, you don't even have to go back to the 16th century. You don't even have to go back that far to a time in the history of the physical sciences when it was thought that water is an element. It wasn't understood that water is a compound until relatively recently in the history of science. So in the history of chemistry. So that would be here again when it was proposed, not the majority opinion, not the widely held opinion, and yet it turned out to be the true opinion. So simply calling something a matter of opinion does not have the consequence that there is no fact of the matter. if it is a matter of opinion, in the sense that no opinion is known to be true, and it's not, and it is a matter of opinion and not a matter of fact, in that sense, of course, it doesn't follow that there is no fact of the matter. All that follows is just that we don't know what the matter of fact is, and the only way that we're going to find out is more critical thinking, more rational investigation, more rational examination. So that would be an example of, here again, an opinion that at one time was held by not very many people, not even very many scientists at the time that it was proposed. And over time, of course, it became well established. We now regard it as a well-established fact, but that was a matter of opinion at a time. Just take any claim about the future, for example. How about, say, for example, suppose the Dallas Cowboys are playing tomorrow, and I say the Cowboys will win the game tomorrow. Well, that's a matter of opinion in the sense that it isn't known what the fact of the matter is, since the game hasn't been played yet. But if I think the Cowboys will win and you think the Cowboys will lose, one of those opinions is the true opinion. We won't know which opinion was the true opinion. We won't know which opinion is the matter of fact until the game has been played. But of course, from the fact that it's a matter of opinion, it doesn't follow that it cannot, here again, become a matter of fact. Or take the statement, the stock market will go up tomorrow. Suppose it's my opinion that the stock market will go up tomorrow, and it's your opinion that the stock market will go down tomorrow. Well, from the fact that we have different opinions, of course, it doesn't follow that our beliefs in any way influence the truth of the matter. If I believe the stock market will go up tomorrow, and I invest my money accordingly, and then it goes down, I lose money. My beliefs about what would happen don't in any way influence what was going to happen. And there, even before we can know which opinion is the true opinion, there is a fact of the matter. The stock market, if I believe that the stock market will go up tomorrow and you believe that it will go down, it can't go up for me and down for you just because we have different opinions. It doesn't follow that those opinions influence the truth of the matter. There is a truth of the matter. And if I believe it will go up tomorrow and I invest my money accordingly, and you believe the stock market will go down tomorrow, and you invest your money accordingly, well, when tomorrow comes and it goes down, I lose money and you make money. It can't go up for me and down for you. There is a truth of the matter, and our different opinions don't influence what the truth of the matter is. Take, for example, the matter of opinion. She will like that dress. Suppose you and I are shopping for a gift for someone, and I say she will like that dress. You are of a different opinion. You are of the opposite opinion that she will not like that dress. Here again, we may have different opinions, but there is a truth of the matter. Our opinions don't influence the truth of the matter. She either will like the dress or will not like the dress. One of those opinions is true. It is a matter of opinion in the sense that we don't know which of the opinions is the true opinion, but it doesn't follow that there is no fact of the matter. In just calling it a matter of opinion, all that we mean is we don't know which opinion is the true opinion. We do not know which opinion is in fact the truth of the matter. But here again, as I've tried to show with some of these examples, beliefs that start off as opinions can become facts. So simply calling something a matter of opinion does not mean that no knowledge is possible. Some of these statements, were once matters of opinion. So that the Earth orbits the Sun would be regarded as a matter of fact now, but it was once regarded as an opinion. Sirius is 200 million years old. That is still a matter of opinion. That question, the fact of the matter with respect to that issue, has not been established, or at least it hasn't been established any more precisely than that. Maybe it can't be established more precisely than that. Maybe 200 million to 300 million is as close as astronomical measurement is going to get with respect to that question. But there still is a fact of the matter. It is either 200 million years old or 300 million years old, or of course some other number is possible. But the different opinions don't influence what the age of the star is. Water is composed of two parts hydrogen and one part oxygen. Here again, now that is regarded as a matter of fact. But that statement was once a matter of opinion. It became a matter of fact by further investigation. The Cowboys will win the game tomorrow, let's say. That would still be a matter of opinion until the game is played. That would still, of course, be a matter of opinion. But even that opinion will become either a matter of fact or... let me start that again. Either that opinion will become a matter of fact, or the opposite opinion will become a matter of fact. So just calling something a matter of opinion doesn't mean that there isn't any truth to be discovered, doesn't mean that there isn't any fact to be established, doesn't mean that there isn't any fact of the matter. There may well be a fact of the matter, and the only way that we're going to get closer to the truth, now maybe in morality and ethics, maybe we can't get as close to the truth ever, as we get in the physical sciences. That's of course a possibility. But the only way that we're going to get closer to the truth is rational examination, rational inquiry, critical thinking about the issue. And when it comes to critical thinking, of course, when it comes to evaluating the reasons that people have for holding their views, we can evaluate those reasons. And that's not a matter of opinion. We can evaluate the evidence or the reasons on which one bases an opinion. And this evaluation is not itself a matter of opinion. So I just gave an example here again of one reason that people have for non-objectivism, for accepting the non-objectivist thesis about morality. The reason that I've been considering here is that there's a distinction between matters of opinion and matters of fact. Well, I have just shown that that is not a good reason for holding the non-objectivist view. That reason by itself does not establish the truth of the non-objectivist view, because that distinction can be drawn in branches of knowledge as well, that are in branches of inquiry, let me say, that are unquestionably accepted as branches of knowledge. So that would be an example of evaluating the reasons that somebody has for holding an opinion. And we can evaluate the evidence or evaluate the reasons on which someone bases his or her opinion. And this evaluation is, again, not itself a matter of opinion. There are standards of correct and incorrect reasoning in logic, in what we might call critical thinking. There are arguments, forms of argument that are clearly fallacious. There are forms of argument that are clearly good. And we know a lot about logic. We know a lot about critical thinking. So we can at least evaluate the arguments or the evidence or the reasons that people have for holding their views on this or that moral question. So merely drawing the distinction between matters of opinion and matters of fact does not establish the thesis that there are no objective moral truths, that knowledge of right and wrong is not a possibility. A closely related reason that people have for holding the non-objectivist view, according to which there is no moral knowledge or there is no truth with respect to right and wrong or good and bad. Another reason that people have, I guess a closely related reason that people have, is the fact of disagreement. So when there is disagreement on some moral issue, oftentimes people will point to the fact of disagreement and say, well, therefore, there's no knowledge is possible here. Well, here again, that's not a good reason for holding the non-objectivist thesis. That is not a reason that establishes the truth of the non-objectivist thesis, the thesis that there is no moral knowledge, there is no knowledge or truth when it comes to right and wrong. That's simply not a good reason for holding that view. Because here again, disagreement exists in science and math as well. So from the fact that there is disagreement about some matter in morals or values, it doesn't follow that there is no fact of the matter. There is disagreement in science and math as well. So here again, I'm giving another assessment of the reasoning that people have for objecting a kind of skeptical or non-objectivist position about morality. And I'm pointing out that the reason is not a good one. Consider the statement, for example, Pluto is a planet. There's disagreement in science about that right now. Historically, there has been disagreement, and then for a time, I think it was regarded as uncontroversial that Pluto is a planet. Now it's a controversial matter again. There is disagreement about that again. Take, for example, the statement Sirius has undergone a change in color. Astronomers, historians of science would disagree about that claim. Different historical accounts, different testimonies, different observations from earlier in history provide some evidence that Sirius has undergone a change in color, but the evidence is inconsistent. Some of the ancient sources describe the color of it as different from how we see it now, but some of them do not. Some of the ancient sources describe the color as much the same that we see it now. So it's a area of disagreement among historians of astronomy and historians of science. It's a disagreement because the evidence is not conclusive one way or the other. So with respect to the ancient sources that say in their time Sirius was red or reddish, some historians of astronomy would point to other factors that might have been influencing that observation rather than an actual change in the color of the star itself. So that's an area where astronomers disagree and historians of astronomy disagree. Now, from the fact that they disagree, of course, it doesn't follow that there's no fact of the matter. It either has or has not changed color. So just as I said with respect to the distinction between opinion, matter of opinion, and matter of fact, from the fact that there is disagreement, it doesn't follow that there is no fact of the matter. There just isn't agreement on what the fact of the matter is. Again, take, for example, the statement, water is a compound, not an element. Now, that would be an example where historically there was disagreement at one time in the history of chemistry. There was disagreement. There is not now. That is well established now, but that would be an example where there was disagreement for some time. And eventually, of course, agreement was achieved. That, here again, went from being an area of disagreement to an area of agreement. So just because there is disagreement with respect to some issue, it doesn't follow that no truth is to be attained, that no truth is to be acquired. It may just be that there's disagreement because the evidence is not enough, or the evidence is inconsistent, or we just don't have the knowledge that we would like to have. But this doesn't go only for morality. This doesn't go only for ethics. There are many areas in life where we don't have the knowledge that we would like to have. So here again, that's not peculiar to questions of right and wrong or questions of value. Let's take an example from math. There is a proof of Fermat's last theorem. That was an area of disagreement for a long time. Fermat was a 17th century French mathematician, and his theorem was that there are no whole numbers greater than 2, a to the n plus b to the n, such that, I should say, a to the n plus b to the n is equal to c to the n. That was Fermat's theorem, and for a long time, mathematicians disagreed about that theorem. Some thought that it was true, but thought that it had not yet been proven. Some thought that it was false, and the ones who thought it was false believe that it could not be proven. Of course, if a statement is false, then it can't be proven. So it took a long time to discover a proof of Fermat's last theorem. It was discovered only relatively recently in the history of math. But that would be an example where mathematicians disagreed for a long, long time. With respect to all these statements in science and math, there was disagreement, or there continues to be disagreement. From the fact that there's disagreement, it doesn't follow that no one is right. We just don't know who is right. So one can look at morality, one can look at questions of right and wrong. Someone says that abortion is morally permissible, and there's disagreement. Another person says that abortion is not morally permissible. There is disagreement. Someone says that capital punishment is morally justified. Another person says that capital punishment is not morally justified. There is disagreement. But from the fact that there's disagreement, it doesn't follow that no one is right. Here again, there is disagreement about virtually everything to some extent. To some extent, there is disagreement on pretty much everything in life. You can even still find people who believe that the earth is flat. If you simply Google Flat Earth Society, there's many people who will tell you that the earth is flat, say, for example. That's an extreme example, obviously. But with respect to virtually everything in life, there is some disagreement. So what should we say about that? Should we say there's no fact of the matter as to whether the earth is flat? I don't think that's the rational way to respond to the fact of disagreement. From the fact that there is disagreement, it doesn't follow that no one is right. So Pluto is a planet. That's a matter of, historically was a matter of disagreement, and then I think was uncontroversial for a time, and then I think is somewhat controversial again. But it doesn't follow that no one is right. Here again, Sirius has undergone a change in color. That's still a matter of disagreement among astronomers. Water is a compound, not an element. That was once a matter of disagreement. Now it is not. Now we know who was right in that disagreement. There is a proof of Fermat's last theorem. Here again, for a long time in the history of math, that was an area of disagreement. But now we know who was right. Their proof of Fermat's last theorem was discovered, and it's now widely accepted in math, and so that would be an example where there was disagreement. But from the fact that there is disagreement about some matter, here again, all that follows is that we don't know who's right. It doesn't follow that no one is right. It doesn't follow that there is no true belief. It just follows that we don't know whose belief is true. So again, there may be reasons for wondering whether we can achieve knowledge when it comes to morality, and when it comes to ethics, when it comes to values. But these first two reasons that I've considered are not good reasons. From the fact that we can draw a distinction between matters of opinion and matters of fact, it doesn't follow that there is no possibility of achieving knowledge in ethics. And from the fact that there is disagreement on many ethical questions, it doesn't follow that there is no possibility of achieving knowledge in ethics. One way that you sometimes hear the non-objectivist thesis supported is by, well, let me put it this way. One will point out that there isn't anyone who is authorized to state in some official way what the truth is. So one colloquial way, one common way of expressing this fact is to ask the rhetorical question, who's to say? When there is disagreement, as there oftentimes, of course, is in ethics, oftentimes in morality, there's disagreement. When parties to the debate disagree, you know, sometimes someone will just say, well, who's to say? As if that somehow means that there's no fact of the matter, there's no truth of the matter to be discovered, to be established. Here again, from the fact that there isn't anyone who is authorized to decree what the truth is, it doesn't follow that there's no truth in morality. It doesn't follow that there's no knowledge in ethics. There isn't anyone who is to say about empirical matters either. There isn't anyone who is to say in the physical sciences either. It's not as if someone's saying something makes it true when it comes to claims in the natural sciences, say, for example. That's what I mean by empirical matters here. That's part of what I mean. Lots of just mundane empirical beliefs would count as well. Beliefs like the cat is on the mat or something like that, just any, or there is milk in the fridge, just any belief that you would have on the basis of evidence or experience or observation. That's what I mean by empirical here. It's not, when it comes to any empirical fact, it isn't as if the fact is what it is because someone has said that it's the case. So when there's a moral disagreement and somebody says, well, who's to say? Meaning, there isn't any truth of the matter. There isn't any fact of the matter to be discovered. Simply pointing out that there isn't anyone who is to say, that is to, that just simply pointing out that there isn't any authority who has the power to pronounce or to decree what the truth is, it doesn't follow from that that there isn't any truth of the matter or any fact of the matter. That here again is not peculiar to morality. That is not peculiar to the subject of ethics. That would go for any branch of human knowledge. There isn't anyone who is to say, so to speak, about empirical matters either. So morality is no different from any other subject matter in this respect. Consider, for example, the statement that water is H2O, kind of widely established, widely known fact, basic fact of chemistry. Well, that statement isn't true because anyone has said it. Has anyone has said that it is true? It's not as if anyone's saying that it's true is what makes it true. There is no one who is to say that water is H2O, for example. The statement water is H2O isn't true because anyone says that it's true. It isn't true because there is some authority who is empowered to decree or to officially pronounce that it's true. That's not what makes statements true, for the most part. I mean, there are a few kinds of exceptional examples. I guess one kind of exceptional example would be an umpire in baseball, say, for example. In some sense, if the umpire says the runner is out, then that does kind of make the runner officially out. And we kind of go on with the game. Everybody has to go on with the game, even when, you know, one team is unhappy with the call. Maybe they might protest or whatever. Maybe the fans on one side will grumble, be unhappy about the call. But in any case, the game goes on once the umpire has made the decision. Well, of course, there aren't any umpires in science. There aren't any umpires in philosophy. There isn't anyone who is empowered to decree that, say, for example, water is H2O. But it doesn't follow from that that there's no truth of the matter. Again, the statement water is H2O, that isn't true because someone has the authority to pronounce that it's true. It isn't true because anyone is to say, so to speak, that it is true. There's no authority who's empowered to decree that it's true. So here again, morality is no different from any other branch of inquiry in this respect. One consideration that people will point to as a reason for holding this non-objectivist view, this view according to which there isn't any knowledge or truth when it comes to right and wrong. One consideration that people will point to is that there is no commonly accepted procedure for determining moral truth. So I've been giving lots of examples from the natural sciences. And in the natural sciences, there are commonly accepted procedures. The empirical method, the method of observation, the method of observational verification. For something like water is H2O, of course, you can go into the lab and demonstrate it according to some empirical method that is widely accepted. Well, it is true that in morality, when it comes to right and wrong, in ethics, when it comes to good and bad, it's true there's no commonly accepted procedure for determining moral truth. But it doesn't follow from that that there's no way of determining truth. Here again, all that follows from that is that perhaps we don't know what the best procedure for determining truth is. That's all that follows from that fact. So again, this consideration does not establish the non-objectivist thesis. It does not establish that there is no knowledge to be attained in ethics. The only way to discover the right procedure is to try to find out what the truth is. Procedures for determining truth, you know, they come to be accepted because they work. It isn't the fact of their acceptance that makes them the right way to determine the truth. So again, in the physical sciences, there are all kinds of examples of empirical procedures for determining what the truth is in a lab, say, for example. But of course, those procedures weren't accepted before the truth was determined. They came to be accepted because people learned over time that those procedures did help them to get the truth. So it's not as if the acceptance of the procedure is what makes the truth discovered true. It can't work that way. Otherwise, no procedure would ever be accepted. It would have to be accepted before it was known what the truth is. But the way that we find out what the best procedures are for determining the truth is by trying to discover the truth. And over time, we come to learn that some procedures are more reliable than others. So take, for example, meteorology. Take, for example, making predictions about the weather. We have lots of ways of doing that now. And as compared to ancient times, the methods that we have are pretty accurate. In ancient times, one way that people, the ancient Babylonians, for example, tried to make predictions about the weather was by slaughtering animals. There was a practice called hepatoscopy, which was slaughtering an animal and then inspecting the pattern of lines on the animal's liver. And somehow, ancient peoples got the idea that you could predict the weather in that way. Well, that's not a good method for determining the truth when it comes to claims about what the weather is going to be at some time in the future. That method was eventually rejected, but it was rejected because over time people, of course, came to see that there were better methods of determining the truth. Now, those better methods, of course, were not initially accepted. So it's not as if those better methods for making meteorological predictions, it's not as if those better methods that we use now, it's not as if they were accepted first, and then the truth came. It's that over time, in trying to discover the truth, meteorologists, scientists, just people in general, learned that those methods worked better. They worked better than hepatoscopy. They worked better than slaughtering an animal and looking at the pattern of lines and thinking that was going to enable you to predict the weather. But here again, there was a time when the better methods, the methods that we use now, the methods that people say, for example, at the Weather Channel would use now, studying the kind of data, collecting the relevant kinds of data, course, having the better kinds of technology for accumulating the data and so for gathering the evidence and so forth. There was a time when none of these procedures was accepted, but even at that time, they were already a better way of determining the truth. It just isn't the case that they were accepted before it could be known that they were the best way to determine the truth. It took time to determine that. It was their reliability that was established over time that led to them being accepted as the truth. As the best method for determining the truth. So it's true that there isn't any You know, when it comes to right and wrong, when it comes to good and bad, when it comes to ethics, morality, it's true there isn't any commonly accepted procedure in the same sense that there are commonly accepted procedures in the physical sciences. Commonly accepted procedures for determining the electrical charge of a body or the chemical composition of a substance, something like that. There isn't anything like that when it comes to, there aren't procedures quite like that in ethics and morality. But the only way that we're going to determine what is the right procedure for getting at the truth is to continue trying to get at the truth.